apparently it was actually Laplace who discovered Bayes theorem, not Bayes. Is that right?
I don't know. And John is the right man to ask, because John has very quickly impressed me with the depth and sharpness of his insight in this field. So a little bit about John Hawkins. He's got a PhD in applied machine learning, bioinformatics to be precise, from University of Queensland, where he also did a postdoc. And then he did postdocs elsewhere, including a stint in Germany, at which point he became someone who lived the dream. Yes, a freelance data scientist. Everyone wants to be one, right? And then that came to a very sad end when he got a job with CBA. I was going to announce him as working at CBA, except today I was checking LinkedIn and I got this note: John Hawkins is now at Channel 9. Would you like to congratulate him? And I did, and I do. John, what gave me the impression that John is the guy to talk to? Because I think it was like two Data Science Sydneys ago. I haven't known you for very long. Two Data Science Sydneys ago, we had two great presenters. We had Thomas. Hands up, Thomas. Where's Thomas? He's over there now. Thomas presented on cyclones, as you recall, and there was also a presentation on neural networks, on recurrent neural networks. Those were the two presentations. And the thing is, there were these really insightful questions being fired over from Siberia. So we're sitting in Siberia and firing great questions, both on the issue of cyclones and on the technical details of, okay, what aren't you telling us about these recurrent networks? And that was John. So this is someone who really knows his machine learning. And today, he's going to cover a topic that I think is one of the more important yet impenetrable topics in machine learning, which is the connection between Bayesianism, the Bayesian approach to statistics, and machine learning. Over to you, John.
Awesome. Well, thanks, Eugene. That's a pretty hard intro to live up to. I'm going to be... actually, just before I start, can I ask who here came to data science through formal statistics? Just a show of hands, roughly? It's a small proportion, okay. So, unfortunately, the bad news for you guys is this should be thoroughly uninformative. for the rest of you, this actually, because I came to statistics through computer science, I was always puzzled by the fact that you've got these two arms of empirical statistics, frequentism and Bayesianism, and they're supposedly equally valid, but yet they give different answers to certain questions. So this talk is basically the culmination of me coming to terms with that fact. So forgive me, it's going to be sort of rewinding a little bit back into sort of history. Is that the clicker there? Yeah. Cool. So to really understand how the idea of Bayesian statistics comes about, you have to sort of think a little bit about the context in which it emerged. And in the early years of probability theory, the reasoning was all about systems in which you kind of knew or assumed that you knew the structure of the underlying probability, for example, coin tosses and rolling of dice or removing balls from urns. You assumed that you knew what the fundamental probabilities were of those individual events, and then you were calculating the probabilities of complicated complexes of them. For example, the probability of if you roll two dice that the sum's going to be greater than 8 or something like that. And lots of important work came out of that, the notion of sample spaces and permutations and combinatorics. But I want you to think a little bit about that assumption that you know the underlying structure, because it's no secret that probability theory came out of studies of games of chance, and not all games of chance have that probability. So when you assume that you know the probability of a coin toss or a dice, it's because of a certain kind of symmetry in the physical structure of the thing that you're dealing with. But not all games of chance are like this. So looking at, say, for instance, knuckle bones, which is one of the oldest games of chance, there is no intuitive way to say what's the actual probability that's going to come up convex or concave side. And in fact, it's probably the study of knuckle bones in which frequentism first emerged. People cottoned onto the idea of that just simply studying large multiple iterations of throwing these things, you can get an estimate of what the underlying probabilities were. At least we can't know for sure, but that seems to be where the idea originally came from. So this process of changing the way you think from in classical statistics, from in classical probability theory, where you know the systems, the properties of some system, and you want to infer the probability of an observable state, gets flipped on its head. And Bayes was part of that change, where you want to go, you've observed some outcomes, and now you want to infer the properties of the underlying system. And it's not intuitively, obviously, the best way to do this. And Bayes wasn't the first person to try it. So the prodigious Jacob Bernoulli spent a good part of the latter half of his life wrestling with this problem. And he essentially laid the groundwork for frequentist statistics. And he was drawn to a related question, which was that if you're going to use what we now call a frequentist estimate of a probability, how certain can you be that that's a good estimate? So, for example, if you're studying a system that generates some binary random variable with a fixed probability, how many observations do you need to make in order to estimate p within certain bounds? And Bernoulli's work led to the law of large numbers, which essentially tells us that we know that for any given bound that we want to estimate with, that there is a sample, we can estimate the sample size that we need to do that. And that, of course, lays the groundwork for the frequentist approach to estimation and inference, and essentially a lot of the science of last century. And the present century, but a lot of that initial work was done last century. Unfortunately for Bernoulli, he was actually never completed his great work, The Art of Conjecture, and there's some evidence that he was so despondent, but by his final results, he was so despondent he just went to his deathbed and carked it, and it fell to his nephew to actually complete the work, because to Bernoulli, the what he called moral certainty involved the how certain you needed to be that your estimate was accurate would equate to a modern p-value of approximately 1 in 10,000, which we all know is for Bernoulli, what that meant was that when he discovered how many samples you needed to take in order to get moral certainty, he was despondent. It seemed like that his system wasn't going to be useful to him. Of course, last century we wound moral certainty back to from 1 in 10,000 to 1 in 20, and then it all works fine. But Bernoulli lays the groundwork for us so that we can then ask questions, the work of last century. For example, what is the probability of observing a series of experimental results if there were no difference between treatment and trial? All that kind of work grows out of what Bernoulli did. Into Bayes. Bayes was also struggling with the same question of how to infer a probability, and he was also intrigued by the problem of how can you have certainty, or how can you estimate your uncertainty in those estimates. But unlike Bernoulli, he didn't have access to all of the latest tools of mathematics at the time. Like he wasn't aware of sequences and series and the work of Leibniz, etc. He was an amateur mathematician, and to him it just seemed probability, the language of probability itself, seemed like a natural fit to talking about uncertainty. But the problem for Bayes was that wasn't how probability had been defined up until that point. But up to that point in time, you could only talk about, probability was restricted to talking about the outcomes of random variables, not to fixed properties of the world that we just didn't happen to know. So Bayes needed to go through this process of redefining probability so that it was actually a representation of our confidence that a certain outcome would or would not occur. And if that sounds like a strange thing to try and do mathematically, just wait till you see how he did it. So here's an excerpt from Bayes' posthumously published essay towards solving a problem in the Doctrine of Chances, and I'll just read it. The probability of any event is the ratio between the value at which that expectation, depending on the happening of the event, ought to be computed, and the value of the thing expected upon its happening. Now, if that sounds gobbledygook to you, it sounds like gobbledygook to me, and it took me quite a few readings. But when you go through it a few times, you get to the point, what he's saying is essentially you have something's going to happen, you've got some expectation of it happening, and there'll be a payoff, and the ratio of that expectation to what you would get if it did happen is what probability is. So expectation, that kind of sounds familiar. We're all used to thinking of the definition of expectation that was devised by Pascal and Fermat to what was known as the problem of points in the early days of probability. This is the idea that if you're playing a game of chance with all your friends, then there's money at stake, and you have to stop for some reason. For example, say you will need to rush to the town square to watch the local witch being burnt, or something equally important. You're going to stop the game. You need to divvy up all of the money. How do you do that? So the answer that Pascal and Fermat gave is what we now know as the expectation. You take a sum of the values of all the potential outcomes multiplied by their respective probabilities. So Bayes inverts this. To us, expectation is based on probability, and Bayes inverts that. He says, no, probability is based on expectation. Expectation's the primary thing. Second key idea in Bayes, and this is probably the most famous, of course, is Bayes' rule. So sometimes people call it a theorem, but really it's just you can derive it from the axioms of probability. The joint probability of two events A and B is equal to the conditional probability of A given B multiplied by the marginal probability of B, and vice versa. The joint probability, is equal to the conditional probability of B given A multiplied by the marginal probability of A, which means that these two things are equal, and with a little bit of rearrangement you come to this, to the formula at the bottom. So I'll come back to this and talk to a little bit more, but the key thing is that on the left hand side, the thing that you care about, A, is what you're trying to estimate, and B is your evidence. You've made some observations, B, and you want to know, the best possible estimate of the probability of A, and that the things on the right hand side are what you need to do that. So are we there yet? We've talked about Bayes' subjective definition of probability, which we've all kind of heard of, although probably not seen the fine details of how he did it, and the derivation of Bayes' rule. Actually, there's two more concepts in being Bayesian that you need to put a list into practice, and they kind of stem from these first two, and that is the idea of assigning a prior and postponing the point estimates. Assigning a prior. So remember, recall that definition of Bayes' rule. Bit of terminology, the thing on the right, Bayesian calls a posterior, because it's your estimate of the probability after the fact. And if you look on the right-hand side, you see that in amongst all the things you need, there's a probability of A. And you might say to yourself, well, hang on, the probability of A is the thing that we want to estimate, but it's already there on the right-hand side. How do we go about doing this? So we need to know the probability A in order to get there, and it's a bit of a conundrum. And Bayes' answer is, well, have a bloody guess. Actually, I mean, really, he's already defined probability as a subjective thing, so it's not, it's coherent with the way he thinks about probability. What's going on there? Postponing point estimates. So remember that the entire reason that Bayes gave a subjective definition of probability was so that he could use it to express uncertainty. So if you take you've got a coin and there's some real probability that it comes up heads, in all likelihood it's probably not exactly 1/2, but it's fixed, and every toss of the coin doesn't involve sampling from that underlying probability. It's from the underlying probability of possible biases. For Bayes, that probability represents uncertainty, so we express our uncertainty about the value of P using a probability distribution itself. So which means that unless we're completely certain, our estimate of P should always be expressed as a probability distribution. Putting that all together, there's four elements that I've talked about which go into being Bayesian: the subjective definition of probability, estimating a prior using Bayes' rule, and postponing a point estimate. So, and that's all pretty abstract, so I'm going to go through a couple of really, really simple examples just sort of see how it all falls into place, and then contrast that with classical and frequentist statistics. So really simple example, we've got a colleague and she has a coin. She tells us that the coin's either two-headed or it's regular, so it's biased with two heads, or it's a regular coin. She flipped the coin and the result was heads. What's the probability that that coin is a regular coin? So it's important to recognise that for a pure frequentist, this question is undefined. The coin she has in her hands is a fixed property of the world. You can't assign a probability to it. But for Bayesian, we can solve it by simply applying Bayes' rule. The probability that it's a regular coin, given that we saw a head, is equal to the expression on the right. The probability of a head, given that it was a regular coin, multiplied by the probability of it being a regular coin, divided by the the probability of being a head. To get the prior is the probability of being a regular coin. In the absence of any other information, what Bayesians tend to do is give a uniform distribution. So we say the probability of being a regular coin is 1/2. That's the best we can do without any other evidence. The conditional probability of a head, given that it's a regular coin, is pretty straightforward. Our definition of a regular coin is that it's unbiased, so that we say that it's equal to 1/2. And the marginal probability of observing head, pH, is basically, we take as an expectation. We look at the two different types of coin, sum over the two different types of coin, regular coin or biased coin, and then take the sum of the probability of that coin identity by the probability of seeing a head if that was the identity of the coin. And we get the result 3/4. Putting those three elements into Bayes' rule, we get the outcome that our posterior estimate that this coin is a regular coin is 1/3. Now, it's interesting to note that this problem definition, as I've worded it, I've worded it deliberately so a frequentist can't answer it. But you can change, a pure frequentist can't answer it. You can reword it a little bit so that it becomes completely amenable to a frequentist. So take this alternative. Someone flips an unbiased coin. If she gets a head, she then chooses a two-headed coin. If she gets a tail, she then chooses a regular coin. She tosses after tossing the first coin, she then tosses a second coin without telling us what she got in the first place. And if she gets a head on that second toss, what's the probability that the first toss was a tail? So what I've effectively done is taken that first problem definition and made that fixed thing that we're told we don't know what it is, I've made it the outcome of a random experiment. And then it's perfectly reasonable for a frequentist to attack the problem. And the interesting thing is that a frequentist and a Bayesian get the solutions exactly the same. You get the same answer once you do that alternative definition. So, making predictions, now that we've got a probability distribution of the estimate of what the identity of that second coin, this condition on our first observation being a head, we think that the probability is 1/3 that it's a regular coin, 2/3 that it's a biased coin. If we want to calculate the probability of the next toss being a head, we just take another expectation. We multiply out the probability of the identity of that coin by the probability of giving a head, if that were the coin, and we get the answer 5/6. So some observations about this. I've deliberately focused on the kind of ruthless definition of being a Bayesian, and that's the next slide. Sorry. although the process that we used to answer the question in the previous slide might seem Bayesian in the alternative definition, we used a probability distribution over the identity of the second coin, and we made use of Bayes' rule. It's perfectly reasonable for a frequentist to follow the same line of reasoning because all the probabilities have been allocated to random variables. So it's only under the original definition that it's undefined for the frequentist. So there's a clear distinction between cases when we use a methodology that looks Bayesian and when we use core Bayesian principles of assigning probabilities to non-random variables. Bayesian principles allow us to answer questions that are not defined for frequentists. However, given that we can just do this reformulation of it, is it really just all sleight of hand? Is there any real difference going on there? So I'm going to use a different example to show one where they you can get different results using the two techniques to sort of dig into that a little bit. Suppose the same colleague then has a coin she tells us could be biased anywhere on the spectrum between always landing heads to always landing tails. And we denote this unknown bias theta, so that the probability of getting a head from that coin is equal to theta. We observe her throwing the coin 10 times and observe 8 heads and 2 tails. And then she asks us several questions. What's our estimate? What's our best estimate of the value of theta? What's the probability that theta is less than or equal to 0.5? And what's the probability that the next toss is going to result in a heads? So for a frequentist, this is all trivial. For the frequentist, we'll use the maximum likelihood estimate to estimate theta, just saying that for basically the observed frequency is our best estimate of the bias. For a frequentist, the second question is undefined because the probability, the actual value is not, you can't use a probability to talk about theta is not a random variable, you can't talk about the probability of having certain values. And the maximum likely estimate of theta gives us an immediate answer to the third question. The probability of the next toss resulting in a head is equal to 0.8. For a Bayesian, it's a little bit more complicated. It begins by you have to assign a probability distribution over possible values of theta. So typically we're going to assign a probabilistic prior, and it's a single value, we'll use a beta distribution, which is you can sample from and you get values between 0 and 1. So it's a parameterized distribution that has this form. I'm not going to talk about the parameterization of that just for a second. The conditional probability of the data given some value of theta is just given by the binomial distribution. So you just plug in the observed frequencies of heads and tails into this, and you get the conditional probability of the data given theta. And then the marginal probability of the data is given by taking an integral over the joint probability. So you just have to integrate over all possible values of theta over the conditional by the marginal to get an estimate of the marginal probability. the posterior probability of theta to a Bayesian, you have to plug in all those previous forms and you get to this, substituting some definitions, and it simplifies to what's at the bottom of the page. Now, I'm not going to go through the details, but if you look at the denominator on that at the bottom there, should look familiar because it's basically another version of what this beta function, which is in the definition of the beta distribution. So if you then substitute that back in, you get this expression here in the middle for the posterior, and that has the nice property of being the functional form of a new beta distribution. So if we assign a uniform prior to theta, which we can do by making alpha 1 and beta 1, then our posterior is now a new beta distribution. And if you look at that, so one of the interesting things you see here is that the final distribution over theta has exactly the same parametric form. Sorry, I already said that. We went from a beta of 1,1 to a posterior of beta 9,3. So that's the beta distribution works with binomial problems in this fashion in what Bayesians call it's a conjugate prior. This is one of the more elegant aspects of Bayesian statistics that you can, whatever form, I don't know if this always applies, but you take whatever the form you take for your prior then carries through to your posterior, and often there are nice elegant rules for how you change that parameterization. Not always. question two, we were asked, what's the probability that theta is less than or equal to 0.5? And now that we've got a probability distribution over theta, we can easily solve that with an integral. We just integrate between 0 and 0.5, and it comes out to approximately 0.09. The third question, we're asked, what's the probability that the next toss is going to result in a head? And again, this is just an expectation. We take an integral over theta times multiplied by its probability, and it comes out to approximately 0.75. Now, it's worth noting that if you're doing this with binomial problems, you don't have to go through all these messy integrals that I've done here. You can actually just, that estimate you can just do with the formula alpha over alpha plus beta. It's the mean of the beta distribution. So if we tabulate that up, the results for this comparison we've done, for question one, the frequentists gave us the response 0.8. The Bayesians gave us a parameterized distribution. For the second question, the frequentists said, we can't answer this. The Bayesian said, here's our answer. And for the final question, estimate the probability that the next toss is going to be ahead. Frequentists said 0.8, Bayesian said 0.75. Now, it's worth noting, just before I continue, that second question, we've been a little bit unfair because frequentists have their own ways about talking about uncertainty. We've just happened to ask the question in such a way that a frequentist couldn't answer it. So here's a quote from a book on bias statistics that says, for example, it's legitimate for a Bayesian to conclude as a result of data analysis that an interval contains a parameter of interest with 95% probability, whereas a frequentist, on the other hand, will use probability to describe how often the calculations that produce the interval will cover the parameter of interest in repeated samples. It's just that Bayesians give you a nice single workflow to go to talk about probabilities of the parameter having certain values and for making point estimates. So who's right? Oh, sorry. Actually, I want to say the thing that I'm more interested in is that final line, the fact that we've got the two different answers to this same question of predicting the probability that the next toss is going to be ahead, 0.8 or 0.75, which of course begs the question, what's the right way to answer problems of this kind? This is the thing that's somewhat confusing about this. So the only way I know to answer those kind of questions, well, not the only way, the way I prefer to answer these kind of questions is through simulations. So let's say we randomly choose theta 100,000 times from a uniform distribution. We take n samples and we apply each of the two techniques to try and estimate the probability that the next toss is going to be ahead. And then we then evaluate whether the Bayesian or the frequentist is closer to the true probability of the next event over those 100k examples, or whether it's a draw. So you'll notice they don't set out up to 100% because sometimes it's a draw. And so what we see here is that at low numbers of samples, the Bayesians have a massive advantage, but it starts to dissipate. Although it has it by 1,000 samples, it still hasn't gone, the difference hasn't gone to zero. Although you might say that we're being a little bit unfair here because in the simulation, we've deliberately chosen theta from a uniform distribution, which is exactly what the Bayesians were assuming. So we've kind of biased the whole thing towards a better outcome from the Bayesians. So let's try a different simulation where we make reality different from the Bayesian assumptions, and we repeat the experiment, but we randomly choose theta from a beta 2.8, a skewed distribution. And here, the frequentists come out on top. So you'll notice that it converges a lot faster. But even at low numbers of samples, the frequentists are superior to the Bayesian approach. So what can we say to this? If you run multiple simulations like this, varying the parameterization of beta distribution, you'll see that even for small amounts of skew, Bayesian still come out on top, but there's always this turning point where which of these two methods works best depends on how far the Bayesian prior is from reality, how far those Bayesian assumptions are from reality, which is unsurprising, really. As the number of samples grows, the solutions always converge, although the rate of convergence depends on the specifics of the problem. So again, we've kind of, the answer to the original question I posed, which is best, the answer is kind of, well, it depends. It depends on how well you can estimate I wanted to say one other thing about that too. Of course, we've been assuming here that Bayesians will just use a uniform prior, and that's not the case. Bayesians don't have to use a uniform prior. It's just for the sake of the simulation. The uniform prior is kind of the default assumption of a lot of Bayesians, and it seems like an easy way to do that simulation. Yeah. But you might think that the poor performance of the Bayesian approach on skewed data is a bit of an issue, because really we know for a lot of the real world problems that data scientists care about, we know we're drawing from skewed distributions. Almost most of the things we care about, for example, customer churn, click rates, conversion rates, fraud rates, all of these things are needle in a haystack problems, and the baseline rates are very, very small, often sub 1%, if not sub 10%. So how does the Bayesian proceed in those circumstances? The uniform prior is easy to talk about because you're basically assuming you just know nothing. How would you go about stating your subjective non-uniform prior expectations of some aspect of the world in terms of parameterized distribution? It's not entirely obvious. You can have a bit of a guess, which some people do. But that leads me to what I want to talk about, the last thing I want to talk about, which is what I see is a kind of a synthesis between frequentism and Bayesianism. So a lot of the time when people do Bayesian statistics, what they're actually doing is this, empirical Bayes, which is basically taking Bayesianism and throwing away the subjective definition of probability. And so instead what you're doing is you need a prior for something, and you don't want to just make it up. So what you do is you look for what class of events in the world does this thing that I care about belong to. So for example, if it's conversion rates on an ad, let's look at all the data we have about ads we've ran and their conversion rates. And that data is what we draw on to create our prior distribution, and then we feed that through the Bayesian machine. Yeah, cool. Okay, so practical conclusions. Essentially, the answer is that which is best really depends. Easy guidelines for knowing when to use frequentism or Bayesianism is to think about the kind of circumstances they were defined for. If you're planning an experiment in advance and you've got control over the number of samples you can take, and what you really want to give is confidence in some confidence bounds on your estimate of a certain variable, then be a frequentist. If, however, you're using data as it comes in and you need to use all the data you've got, you don't have control over the sample size, and you need to make the best possible estimate in time, and, big caveat there, you're able to make reasonable prior estimates, either because you just think you can guess particularly well, or because you've got some decent way of estimating an empirical prior, then be a Bayesian. Any questions?
So to me, it looks like I'm a new probability frequentist. So in a frequentist point of view, you have a simple number, which is the probability of something happening.
Yeah.
And then with a Bayesian approach, you naturally use a probability distribution, which gives a measure of your uncertainty in what the previous frequentist value was.
Yeah.
Does the stack keep going up? Can you have uncertainty in your measure of uncertainty and so on? It looks like I'm deadly serious. Yeah. So it looks like the frequentist finds like a first order approach, and the Bayesian one you described a second order approach. Surely there's measures of uncertainty, and so on.
Mm.
Like you said yourself, that to do some of this, you have to choose a prior, and you don't know exactly what that prior is supposed to be, so you just make a guess.
Yeah.
So there's some uncertainty in your understanding of what the prior would be, which you cannot seem to incorporate into the second order system. there a third order system where you can write that down?
Well, I think I'm pretty close to maximal uncertainty on this question. I don't know. But I guess that's what the simulations are about. So the simulations I've been doing are about sort of saying, okay, well, I don't really know which of these two is a better way to express uncertainty. Let's run some simulations and
that's
see.
That's like exactly where you started. Well, in some senses.
Actually, have a command. Any hierarchical models doing this? Could you just repeat that? I think that hierarchical models are doing exactly this. So
okay.
How you get uniform distributions on the parameters. I have another question, actually. I'm not a mathematician. I came from physics. If I remember correctly from my physics studies, the frequentist probability comes from the measure theory, which is actually on itself a background for any integration that we know today. At the same time, most of the Bayesian estimates are more than just multiplying fractions.
Yeah.
It's more like estimating complex distributions.
Yeah.
And what I see in practice is that most of these distributions are just sampled using the Gibbs sampler, which is an empirical estimation of a measure. So my question, how do you think that most of the Bayesian, real Bayesian or practical Bayesian methods, they still resort to the frequentist methods?
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. I think that what they're actually doing is using a Bayesian methodology, and they're just substituting frequentist methods to get the priors.
I get exactly the same thing.
Yeah.
Any from the first example?
Yeah. Which part of it? Definition?
The first slide.
Interested in your concept of empirical Bayesian things. Whenever I talk to people who are doing Bayesian things, they often seem to pick the prior largely based on whether it has a nice, elegant prior.
Rather than
I actually believe prior to running an experiment that this is the distribution.
Yeah.
So how, given the spirit of Bayesianism tends to be, you should have your initial belief and then update that, it sounds like empirical Bayesian stuff is more in line with that vision of what Bayesianism is.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess I think of that as Bayesian regularization.
One more question, because we are pressed for time. Or zero questions. What's the probability?
Given sufficiently large number of iterations, does it matter who you are?
No. Yeah, I don't think so. Well, I'm sure you could find a problem. I don't think so. No.
And if no, then is there a way to estimate that sufficient number of iterations?
I think that's what Bernoulli was all about. That's my interpretation. Yeah.
I didn't understand.
Yeah, I mean, he wasn't answering that specific question, but I'm sure you could. Yeah. Well, so Bernoulli is saying he wants to answer the question of how many samples do I need for a given problem in order to get an estimate within a pre-specified bound of the real value. So you could kind of say effectively that number of samples. You know, when you're getting to that point, you have a fair idea that the Bayesian and the frequentist are going to be converging. I don't know for sure. I'm sure that's my feeling.
All right, please join me in thanking John.
Yeah, look, as Eugene said at the start, look, I purely focus on data science recruitment. If any, we're coming to the time of year around Christmas, if you're looking for something new for next year, please come and talk to me. If anyone's looking to build teams for next year, again, please come and talk to me. Good to see you all.